And I'm not even sure that I shared the vision with Tony, so I'm going to remind us all. Our vision is to be a world leader in education, cultivating exceptional thinkers prepared for the future. And this is what Tony is all about. It is a fun story. I have actually met Dr. Wagner a couple of times at mutual meetings. He would not remember me. They were in big audiences, and I've been an admirer of his work for a number of years. And when I first came to SAS, Tim Stewart and Tico Ohms were locked in a room scheming on how we're going to get some really interesting work, and they were doing this around the book, The Global Achievement Gap by Tony Wagner. So it's been an interesting journey for sure. It is fortuitous that Dr. Wagner is here at this point in our journey. A little bit about Tony Wagner. He serves as an expert in resident at Harvard University's new Innovation Lab. And he was the first Innovation Education Fellow at the Technology and Entrepreneurship Center at Harvard and founder and co-director of Change Leadership Group at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. He, of course, is a frequent speaker and international conferences and widely published author. His most recent work is Creating Innovators, The Making of Young People Who Will Change the World. It was published in 2012. He published The Global Achievement Gap in 2008. And recently, he just published a 60-minute documentary, a film, called The Finland Phenomenon, Inside the World's Most Surprising School System, and is the education advisor for a brand new education documentary called Most Likely to Succeed, which was at the 2015 Sundance Film Festival. It really is a pleasure to have an innovative thinker, an educational leader, a new friend and colleague. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Tony Wagner.
Well, first of all, a question. How many of you are here primarily in your role as parents? Raise your hands. So great that you could take time to do this. And how many of you, of course, are teachers? Have any students? Some students. Wonderful. Great. Well, I'm particularly appreciative to teachers because you've already had a long work day, and for you to come of your own volition to this conversation is something that I enormously appreciate. And I promise you it will be a conversation. I'm going to try to limit my initial remarks to maybe 25 minutes or so. And I'm going to invite you at your seats in pairs to talk about what you heard, what you agreed with, what you disagreed with, but most importantly, what your questions are. Because we're going to spend the remainder of our time talking about your questions. For me, that's the part I look forward to. So, I have to tell you, I've had an extraordinary afternoon. And I really mean that. I visit schools all the time. I'm a recovering high school English teacher. Nothing I like better than to go visit schools and talk to teachers and spend time in classes. But I don't remember having ever been to a school as old and established as this that is taking the ideas of educational research and development and innovation so seriously, so thoughtfully, in such kind of courageous and committed ways. I've just been enormously impressed by everything that I've seen and heard. The energy, the thoughtfulness, the commitment. My job, I think, is to try to sort of frame the problem that I think these educational innovations are working to solve. Now, Einstein once said, the formulation of the problem is often more important than the solution. So what's our education problem? Why do you need innovation? I mean, hey, this is a wonderful school. If it ain't broke, why in the heck is he and they trying to fix it? Simply this. Peter Drucker coined the term knowledge worker in 1959. People have described the last half century as an era of the knowledge economy. You know, the industrial economy has been sort of in decline, and certainly in many countries for many, many years. That's being done by robots everywhere. But what people don't realize is the knowledge economy is also now being done substantially by computers. Knowledge is collected, aggregated, and analyzed by computers. Knowledge today has become a free commodity. It's like air, it's like water. Growing exponentially, changing constantly, it's on every internet-connected device. It used to be that we teachers had a corner on the knowledge market. We were the only ones who had access to the papyrus reeds, the clay tablets, the scrolls, and then those expensive things called books. So if you wanted knowledge, it was a scarce commodity. You had to get it through us, the teachers. But if it's right here, what's the teacher's role in the 21st century? What's the purpose of school? What's the value added of a school like this in the 21st century? When the world simply no longer cares how much your kids know. That's a commodity. No competitive advantage. What the world cares about is what they can do with what they know, which is a brand new and completely different education problem. Not a knowledge economy anymore, it's an innovation era today. It's what you can do with what you know that is the value add, the competitive advantage. What does that mean? What does that mean for us as teachers and as parents? You know, the average four-year-old asks 100 questions a day, and nearly every kindergartner thinks of himself or herself as an artist. But by the time most children are 12, they figure out it's much more important to get the right answers than to keep asking good questions. And very few think of themselves as artists. And yet some of those qualities are at the very heart of what it means to be an innovator. I think there are two kinds of innovations. One is an innovation that is about bringing new possibilities to life, and that's pretty rare. It may be a matter of kind of particular time and particular talent. Think of Steve Jobs. But there's another kind of innovation, and that is someone who is a creative problem solver. You can be a problem solver without creativity, no innovation. You can be all kinds of creative and not know how to apply that, not likely to be innovation. And it's the creative problem solving capability that I think is in greatest demand in this world, not just in high tech, in science, technology, engineering, math, but also in the nonprofit world, also in the world of citizenship. Creative problem solving is the competitive advantage, is the corner ground for work, for learning, for citizenship. So what must we do differently as parents and as teachers to develop the capabilities of many, many more of our young people to be the creative problem solvers that they want to be and that we need them to become? That question has been the focus of my work for the last few years. So how did I go about trying to answer this? I interviewed a wide variety of young people in their 20s, some from privilege, some from poverty, some born in the US, some were foreign born. But all of them were creative problem solvers, demonstrably so. So then I wanted to try to understand what were the factors that had developed those capabilities. I interviewed all of their parents to see if I could discern patterns of parenting. Asked them about their education. And it was in asking about their education that I made what was for me the first troubling discovery. Some of these kids have been to the nation's, the world's best universities, Harvard, Stanford, MIT, Carnegie Mellon. And to a person, every single one of them told me they had become innovators in spite of their university schooling, not because of it. But I pushed further. I said, come on, there must have been, you know, a teacher who made a difference. Tell me about a teacher who made a significant difference in your life. Most could name one or two, rarely more than that. Great range of those teachers was from kindergarten all the way to graduate school. So I went and interviewed all of those teachers, watched some of them teach. And that led to my second troubling discovery. In every single case, those teachers were outliers, teaching in ways that were fundamentally different than their peers, but remarkably similar to one another, as I observed. Didn't know each other, but had figured out on their own substantially similar ways to teach. Then I spent time observing in those few schools that really do teach creative problem solving. And it didn't take me long, frankly, because there aren't very many. But I went to the brand new MIT Media Lab, now I guess a decade and a half old, the brand new Olin College of Engineering, the D School at Stanford, High Tech High, where some of your teachers have gone, New Tech High, Expeditionary Learning School, some Reggio Emilia classes, some Montessori classes, the Bing Nursery School on the campus of Stanford. And that led to another discovery. What I saw for learning and teaching across all of those grade levels and schools, from coast to coast, was remarkably similar to one another and to how my outlier teachers were teaching. Very similar kinds of teaching and learning across all of those schools, disciplines, and teachers. So what I've come to understand through this inquiry is that the culture of conventional schooling, the culture we all grew up with, the culture that continues to be practiced and perpetuated, that's 100 years old or more, that culture of schooling is very fundamentally and very radically at odds with a culture of learning that develops the capacity to be a creative problem solver. Five fundamental contradictions that I discern. Number one, conventional culture of schooling is all about measuring and rewarding individual achievement. Well, that's fine, except that innovation is above all a team sport. There is no deep innovation without collaboration. It's the opening sentence to Walter Isaacson's newest book about innovators. Knowing this, these teachers build accountable teamwork, emphasis on accountable teamwork into every single project or unit of study with their students. And they team taught whenever possible, because they had come to understand that one of the most crippling things about education is the fact that most of us teach alone all day, every day. Isolation is the enemy of improvement. Isolation is the enemy of innovation. It's one reason why I think the whole idea of project-based learning, your learning groups, I just lost the word, PLCs, I knew it began with a P, I think it's so important. So contradiction number two, we divide and conquer the school universe by subject content areas. You know that system began in 1893. It was a committee of 10 headed by then Harvard President Charles Eliot, who decreed that we were going to create these things called Carnegie units, and that's how we're going to divide and conquer the school universe, separate, discrete subjects. Here's a little problem. Innovation today almost never happens within the constraints of individual disciplines. Judy Gilbert, then director of talent at Google, said to me, there's one thing educators must understand, is that problems can neither be understood nor solved within the bright lines of individual academic disciplines. Knowing this, these teachers built interdisciplinary courses around large essential questions or problems that wanted to be understood. Contradiction number three has to do with the culture of the classroom. So often what I see, particularly in high schools, is a culture of passivity, culture of colleges too, the same. A culture of passivity, a culture of infantilization, a culture of consumption. The purpose of class is to acquire knowledge, and the only person who has any knowledge worth acquiring is the guy doing all the talking at the front. Radically different in these classes that teach creative problem solving, where the emphasis is on trying to solve real problems, do work worth doing, where the teacher sees his or her role as that of a coach, coaching students to a higher performance standards and empowering students. It's a culture of creativity versus a culture of consumption, a culture of generativity versus a culture of compliance. You feel it the minute you walk into the classroom. These last two contradictions, I think, are the most challenging of all. Contradiction number four is all about the F word. Not that one. Failure. Failure is the worst thing that can happen to anybody in school. Failure is at the heart of most of us in our adult nightmares. We have failures of fear of not being ready for an exam. Failure is what drives, fear of failure is what drives too many of us too long in school. Fear of failure creates not just a culture of compliance, but a culture of risk aversion. But here's the problem. Innovation demands that you take risks, that you make mistakes, and that you fail. I went to IDEO, the most innovative design company in the world. The company motto is fail early and fail often. Other companies say fail fast, fail forward, fail cheap, but fail. Why? Because innovation is a process of trial and error. There is no innovation without trial and error. I would argue there is no real learning without trial and error. What if we said to our children, okay, you cannot speak a word until you can speak in perfect grammatically correct sentences. Sorry, don't try. And none of this crawling stuff. We want you to stand up straight and walk. No falling down. Oh, we can't possibly have you learn to ride a bike because we know you're going to fall and skin your knee. How many of you learn more from your mistakes than from your successes? Raise your hands. All of us. What happens when we get to school? We penalize mistakes, don't we? We call them failures. I am more and more convinced that there's only one kind of failure in school that we should be called a failure, and that's the failure to not try at all, to not show up. Everything else, from my point of view, ought to be thought of as iteration. It's my new favorite word, iteration. Moving from 1.0 to 2.0. I learned that from an Olin College student. She said, we don't talk about GPAs here, we don't care about grades, but we obsess about iteration. That is, learning to look at our work and reflect on what went well and what didn't with this particular project or this course, and then applying what we've learned to the next iteration, 2.0, 3.0. We're talking about that with teachers today. But there's no failure if your work is informed by the research or the literature, and if it's conscientious, if you've reviewed it with peers. It's no such thing as failure in the classroom. That's particularly important for teachers, because I think we teachers are risk-averse as individuals. And that's one thing that stops many of us from trying something new. We're afraid we're going to be judged by our peers, by our kids, by our parents. We're afraid of failing, because we've spent so long in this world of great. Talk to folks at the D School at Stanford, teachers there, quite serious. They said, you know, we're really come to decide F is the new A. Now, I'm not recommending that for your new grade policy, right? It needs a little iteration. But the whole point is that really, in real life, there are only three grades that matter. You're considered competent or you're incompetent. And occasionally, some people are truly outstanding, excellent. In school, what does that mean to me? A, B, or incomplete. The only grades I can justify. A B is the performance standard that we should expect of every student in every course. And we may vary the amount of time or support kids need to meet that standard, but that's the standard. That's what I did when I taught college courses most recently. To the last contradiction. It's about motivation, and it's arguably the most important of all. We rely, I think, far too heavily on extrinsic motivation to motivate learning. Fear of failure being number one. Rewards with good grades. You know, parents even giving tangible, material rewards for good grades. But what I discovered when I interviewed these young innovators, and many people since, all over the world, is that many of these young innovators today, and many of the millennials, are far more intrinsically motivated, wanting to make a difference more than they wanted to make a lot of money. Did their best work in school because it was work worth doing, not just because they wanted to get an A. So I wanted to understand why. How have these kids kind of evolved a different ethos, a different set of motivations? So I went back and looked at all of my interviews with parents and teachers, and I made finally, what I think is the most interesting discovery of all. Both parents and teachers had explicitly encouraged three things: play, passion, and purpose. Parents encouraged much more exploratory play, more time outside, fewer toys, toys you did stuff with, like sand, clay, paint, blocks, and then everybody's favorite, Legos. They limited screen time. Even the parents who were in very high-tech fields were adamant about limiting screen time. Teachers tried to bring a spirit of play back into the classroom. It was Ed Carrier who teaches an incredible course called psychometrics. it combines electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, and computer science to engineers at Stanford. And he talked about bringing an element of whimsy into the kinds of projects he would dream up for his teams of students. About, first of all, trying to provide selectively their children with opportunities to try new things, just to see what they're most interested in and engage them. They were very observant, too. They wanted to see, you know, where were their children most engaged? And if something didn't engage their kids, they weren't afraid to sort of say, let it go. Because the parents, I discovered, believed it was more important for young people to find and pursue a real interest than academic achievement for its own sake. Because they believed that, yes, the things we talk about now is grit, perseverance, tenacity, self-regulation, self-discipline, critically important, more important than raw IQ for adult well-being. They are best learned because you're intrinsically motivated, not because you have a tiger mom sitting on your shoulder screaming at you for 10,000 hours. That intrinsic motivation, they felt, was best evolved out of a sense of passion. Teachers, too, tried to bring a spirit of intrinsic motivation and passion into the work, and trying to keep a student's sense of curiosity alive. More and more today, I'm meeting teachers who are bringing what they call Google time into the classroom. What do I mean? How many of you know the Google rule? Raise your hands. Go to work for Google, you have permission to play on company time, you build it a day a week. Not just Google. 3M has been doing it for 50 years. Gore Associates. These companies have found that if you give people opportunities to pursue a passion in a work context, the innovation rate goes up dramatically. So what some teachers are doing now is creating time and space in their curriculum for students to pursue a passion. I got an email from a fifth grade teacher in a well-regarded private school about 4 weeks ago. She said, you know, I heard you talk about Google time. Here's what I did. Instead of assigning my children, my students, homework for the weekend, I told them it was their Google time. And I asked them to tell me how they were planning to use it and then report back. And she said, some students want to cook these amazing meals. Some were starting to work to play a new instrument. Some wrote stories, did art. They all used their time in completely different ways. And she was stunned at the level of energy and excitement that they brought in on those Mondays. What happened with these kids, though, these young adults, is they, and by the way, you know, when I talk about finding and pursuing a passion, almost every high school student starts getting nervous. They think, oh, I don't know what I'm passionate about. I have no idea. So it starts with, what are you curious about? What do you want to know more? Or maybe what do you want to get a little better? It doesn't start as a full-blown passion. But my point is that it also evolves. Passions morph and change over time. But in every single case, with these young adults, it matured into a deeper sense of purpose, a desire to, in some way, give back or make a difference. And that's because I discovered both parents and teachers had explicitly encouraged young people to think clearly. We are not here just on this earth merely to serve ourselves. We have some responsibility to give back and to make a difference, even if only in small ways. And we must work hard to understand and empathize with others who are different from ourselves. Well, I'm going to stop at this point, because I promised to be brief. I've gone on even a little longer than perhaps I might. So I'm going to invite you to take about 5 minutes and pair up with your neighbor and talk about what you heard, what you agreed with, disagreed with, found interesting, found troubling. But most of all, what are your questions? Take about 5 minutes. One on each side of the auditorium. Raise your hand, please, and they will come to you so we can all hear your question. We're also doing a videotape of the session. I want to make sure that we get everybody's questions. So raise your hand and the mic will hopefully come. Two hands back there, way, way back. I thought we had another mic. Oh, there. Okay.
you use the terminology Google time. Isn't that just free time for kids?
Oh, I'm glad you asked that. Here's the distinction I make. First of all, I put it in the context that I think every student should have a digital portfolio that follows them through school. And the digital portfolio becomes an important way where students show progressive mastery of core competencies over time in a body of work. And then we assess students by a body of work, not by an individual work, which builds in the whole idea of iteration. But in the whole idea of Google time, students talk about how they're going to use this time, and they make a commitment as a learning plan, as a part of their digital portfolio. And then they periodically meet with a teacher and talk about what they did, what they learned, and what they're going to do next. So that it's never considered free time. It's independent study time, it's Google time, but it is not, emphatically not free time. Thanks for asking. And here?
As an educator in the primary school and as a mother of a first and a second grader, how do you see universities changing in the next 10 years to better prepare students for the future?
That's, again, a critical question, and one that I know is of particular concern to parents, and one that was, I think, of concern to the development team where we met this afternoon, worrying about, well, if we veer from the straight and narrow as a school, will that negatively impact admissions to colleges? There is a quiet revolution going on in colleges. The education problem we have today is K-16. It's not K-12. I'll use a quick example. Google was famous or notorious, depending on your point of view, for only hiring kids with Ivy League degrees, and they would only interview kids who had the highest GPAs and test scores. Laszlo Bock comes along, Senior VP of People Operations, analyzes the data, and determines that these indices are, quote, worthless, his words. Goes on to say the skills you need to succeed in a competitive academic environment bear absolutely no relationship with the skills you need to succeed in an innovation economy. So I thought, well, that's Google. A year ago, I am in Ho Chi Minh City at the invitation of Deloitte, the accounting and consulting firm, had lunch with the CEO, and she quite spontaneously said to me, you know, we used to hire the best kids from our best universities, but she said, they didn't work out so well. Risk averse, unable to collaborate. She said, now we look for good students and we put them through a summer-long boot camp to see how they solve problems collaboratively. My point is that there are tremendous pressures on the college market right now. Pressures from massively open online courses. Why do you need to spend $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 a year acquiring knowledge at a school when you can get it for free online? It's a huge pressure. Pressures from employers. Kids today are leaving college with a lot of debt and no skills. Right now today, the combined unemployment and underemployment rate of recent four-year American college graduates, guess that number, combined unemployment, underemployment rate, 53%. And it's barely budged in the last 2 years. When I say underemployed, what do I mean? I mean kids who are BA restants. Or BA artenders. Kids who are barely making minimum wage and are unlikely to be able to pay back the average of $30,000 of college loan debt that they've acquired. The default rate now is only at about 15%. I think it's going to go up astronomically. So that's another pressure on colleges. Another pressure on colleges is that many are coming to realize that the vaulted advanced placement programs are producing kids who memorize a bunch of stuff and forget it the minute school is over. So colleges like Dartmouth have most recently decided to eliminate any advanced standing or advanced credits for students having passed AP exams. None, gone. Finally, I think more and more colleges have come to realize that what they use for the admissions criteria, those tests, are in fact very, very class biased. And are selecting out large groups of kids who might otherwise thrive. Right now today, there are 850 colleges and universities, including very selective schools, that are completely test optional. Bates, Bowdoin, Colby, Carleton, Holyoke, Middlebury, some name brand schools. So this is a long way of saying that in the next decade, we're gonna see tremendous ferment in the whole college environment. Even this year, MIT, for example, has said it would like to see portfolios of student work as a part of the admissions process. Imagine that. MIT saying, we want to look at student work, not just a number or a transcript. Tufts has been a leader in doing experimentation with different approaches to admissions. A few years ago, they invited students to make their own YouTube videos as a part of admissions, discovered they were far more interesting and far more revealing than their application essays. So finally, this is a school that has a reputation. You build on that. This is a school that most colleges will continue to want graduates from into their universities. That's not going to suddenly change because you do an advanced topics curriculum instead of AP. That's not going to change at all. And what I think you're going to find is that students who go through a very different kind of education are going to be more able to take initiative, more able to ask really good questions, more able to hack college. What do I mean by that? Go to college with purpose. Go to college and being able to design a set of experiences, both in classrooms and out of classrooms, that will amount to something, as opposed to simply going through college because it's an expectation. It's about being an active, intentional learner. Sorry to spend so much time on that question, but I do think it's a critical one, and I know it's a fear that many have. Other questions? Raise your hand, please, for the mic.
I've had this conversation a few times, and I hear that if I can Google it, then I don't need to know it. And I was recently in Bali over spring break, and sometimes Google doesn't work, or your cell phone, so that mantra doesn't work. So what is that minimum core knowledge that kids need to have leaving school that allows them to be productive even when the internet's down?
That's a really important question. Do I want to have to, take out my phone and Google the times table in order to figure out, what tip I leave tonight? No. I'm glad I've memorized my times table. I wouldn't take that back. All kids are going to need three things. They're going to need content knowledge. And the challenge is within and across disciplines figuring out what is foundational. Does every kid need to memorize every last thing in the biology textbook and then next year chemistry and next year physics? No, I don't think so. Do they need to know how to think like a scientist? Do they need to know the scientific method? Do they need to have actually had experience in designing, first of all, developing a hypothesis, designing an experiment, testing that hypothesis, analyzing the results, and then presenting their findings? Yes, absolutely. Now, curriculum is a limited piece of time. You're gonna have kids memorize more stuff or do science. Those are the tough trade-offs and choices we have to make. So content knowledge matters. So three things every young person will need to thrive in the future. They will need content knowledge. We gotta figure out how much and what. They will need skills. They will need, I'll give an example of the trade-off. I'm recovering high school English teacher. I used to spend a lot of time teaching parts of speech because everybody told me, oh, that's content they gotta have. It was usually the foreign language teachers who told me they had to have it, but never. So, and I would have to look it up every night. It would not stick in my head what a gerund was. Best I can remember is a noun acting strangely. But anyway, my point is, I didn't see any payoff. But when I actually started having kids do a lot more writing without necessarily knowing the parts of speech, other than noun and verb, that's fine, the writing got dramatically better. And then I went and checked the research. There is no research whatsoever to show that knowing the parts of speech makes you a better writer any more than knowing the parts of an internal combustion engine makes you a better driver. So we have to be much more mindful about what content knowledge, and then spend much more time on skills. And I'd start with the four C's: critical thinking, collaboration, communication, and creative problem solving. We have to define, what do we mean by critical thinking? It's a buzzword, but when you really look at the literature, it's around habits of question asking, problem identification. And then finally, we need to pay attention to motivation. It's content knowledge, skill, and will, meaning motivation. And of the three, I think motivation is the single most important, because if you're motivated, you will continuously learn new content knowledge and new skills, which you'll have to do all your life. And it's the one we often do the most damage to with our current forms of school. We kill motivation. Yes, please. Wait for the mic. Right here.
And Mike, because I just don't know where the information is, it was interesting to hear you say that colleges are under a lot of competition with online, and we are just starting, I've only got a 10th grader, but we're doing a college tour because we have limited time every year. And how to identify a college, we've spoken with a counselor, you get the books, you look at the things, and I'm British, so I'm going through an American system. Where is the book that says, throws out everything that's in these little books here that we've got now, these big volumes that says, we're skills-based. We're doing, because you're telling us that we need to be creative and it's critical thinking, and we keep telling our sons about skills, and we talk about skills that he learns outside of school. But when you look at the application requirements, it still seems to come down to the GPA, the SAT, and that, you know, do you fit at the right number of Caucasian, this, that, what, that. It's crazy.
Yeah.
Where is the book that says these are the innovative, skills-based schools that are going to make a difference and turn out students that are motivated and valuable to society?
I agree. I mean, I frankly worry that many colleges, many undergraduate schools are perpetuating fraud. Best liberal arts schools say they're teaching critical thinking and communication, but they refuse to assess them. How do they know? How do we know? I'll tell you what we know. We know from an assessment called the Collegiate Learning Assessment, which is a very good assessment of analytic reasoning, critical thinking, problem solving, and writing, that half the kids after 2 years of college, half, across all kinds of colleges, are no better at those four skills than when they started college. And the third, 36%, are no better than when they finish. This is in a new book called Academically Adrift. And then the following book, Young Adult Adrift or something like that, by the same authors, discovers that the kids who have these skills and did well on that assessment are far, far more likely to be employed in a good job and not living at home. So there is more attention being paid to these skills. My own advice would be a couple of things to think about. I don't think going to a name brand college is the competitive advantage it once was. It simply isn't. It may help you get an interview because of the network. It's not going to get you your first job. This is what I was saying about Google. More and more kids are going to have to go to graduate schools. So I say save your money. Find a good state school, you know, and think about saving money for graduate school. I've even had parents approach me and say, you know, we're thinking of doing this. We're saying, all right, here's $250,000, what we would spend on 4 years of undergrad. You can go to college, pick your college, or you could start a new business. Which would you rather do? That's an interesting choice. But above and beyond that, I would stay away from Research One universities because there is zero incentive to teach well. Money is entirely on research. Harvard, all the way on down. Those schools don't care very much about their undergraduates. They don't pay much attention to good teaching. Unlike a Williams or a Carleton or a Bates or a Bolton or a Colby, which I think pay a lot more attention to that. But you know, when you pick your school, you pick your complaint. There's no perfect school. There are a few out there. I mean, the Olin College of Engineering. It's very interesting to me that while you need certain cut scores to get into the final applicant pool, before you're accepted into the Olin College of Engineering, you have to go to one of four candidates' weekends. What do they do there? They put the kids in teams and observe how they solve problems in teams, and the final admissions decision is made blind, entirely based on what was observed while the students were in teams for that candidate's weekend, without any reference to their academic records. And that college right now is the leading engineering college in the country after only 10 years. O-L-I-N, remarkable school. All project-based, all interdisciplinary, all team-based. Their senior year, all our students do, they work in teams on a real problem and a real business for most of their senior year. They also all have to do a fine arts or liberal arts minor. So it's not just all STEM. The joke about the orchestra, the well-known, highly regarded Olin College Orchestra, doesn't have a conductor, according to the literature. It doesn't even have a semiconductor. Question here. First back there, then down here.
I would like to know how come you think collaboration, creativity, problem solving, communications are 21st century skill. To me, you know, it's 18th, 19th century yes. skill as well because of the
I completely agree.
Industrialization.
Everybody here, that I first of all didn't use the term 21st century skills. I've never used it in my writing. Others have. But here's the critical difference. For thousands of years, the elites have needed most of those skills, arguably not collaboration, but critical thinking, creative problem solving, communication skills. But today, every student, not just the elites, need those skills for work, learning, and citizenship. That's the fundamental difference. That's what's changed. This one, right here.
Can you hear me, Tony? Thank you. Good, very good discussion. An SAS parent and a business executive. I want to change the conversation a little bit from school to Googles and Microsofts of the world, right? I read your presentation on the Mars-Venus comparison between educators and business executives. And Tony, I wonder if you could speak a little bit about how some of the points that you are talking to us parents and teachers, you know, how are you taking those messages to the business executives? So they are open to all the fantastic comments that you shared with us, and how do students...
That's a great question.
Thank you.
And an important one, because I think business and community leaders have a vital role to play in this education transformation work. They have got to be much more explicit about the skills that matter most, about the outcomes that matter most for work, and they also have to talk about citizenship, which they rarely do. And so I think there's a very important role that business and community leaders need to play. But here's what I worry about. I was invited to speak to Fortune 200 CEOs. There were more than 100 of them in the room, heads of Fortune 200 companies. So they were the only people allowed into the room. And I had over an hour with them. And then I was able to stay for the next day for informal conversations. And the head of one energy company candidly sort of confided at lunch. He said, you know, I heard you, and sure, we'll give some money to STEM, science, technology, and math, but we're not going to take on this education problem. It's not worth the risk to us. I think their handlers tell them they don't know enough about education, it's too fraught with danger, so stay away from it. Very different than 25 or so years ago when Lou Gerstner, CEO of IBM, and David Kern, CEO of Xerox, were real leaders in the first transformation of education in America. We don't have similar leaders, even though a number of them, like Jeff Bezos, Jimmy Wales, who started Wikipedia, the two guys who started Google, they all went to Montessori schools. And they credited the Montessori experience with what helped them to become innovators and entrepreneurs. But they're not public advocates. Research uncovered that just in the last few years. So that's my concern. Time for maybe one or two more?
Eric, you talk a lot.
Okay. Let's see. It's kind of a recommendation, if you could. Can people hear me? Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
Recommendation to administrators, board, teachers, parents. I think the issue that's brought up right here is so often we have this ethical dilemma where there's these two choices which each seem like they have value, which is the college admissions option or the innovation. And they both have value and merit. And yet, there's a finite amount of time and a finite amount of resources. So what advice can you give to us when we have to make that choice so that it becomes an or choice and not an and? Because too often the and becomes a burden on the students. So
that's a great question. Let me try to repeat it for the audience. Basically, he was suggesting that do we have to choose either or? Do we have to either choose a traditional education or this newer approach? And it's actually interesting that I've seen there's a private school called MidPack in Honolulu that had tremendous pressure from some members of the board and teachers to create a very much more innovative program. So they basically created a school within a school that was a choice option for teachers as well as for families. And that may be something to consider here in the short term. I think, you know, by nature, some people are going to be more traditional, more conservative when it comes to education, and they're going to want to wait and see. And I think that's a fair stance. Others are going to say, look, I know what the limits of traditional education are. I'm not waiting. I want to jump into it now. I want to go yesterday. So maybe you need a two-track system, at least for a period of time, where you provide much sooner than later a very different, more interdisciplinary, more project-based, more inquiry-based set of experiences for students and teachers that can be chosen, opted in for. But that with the understanding that over time, more and more are going to move in the direction of the choices. It's a, you know, there are pros and cons to that, because then you split the school. But it is, I think, a strategy worth considering carefully in terms of its pros and cons. Yeah?
So my question, along the same lines, although thinking of being a teacher in a public school system, teaching something like AP chemistry, where you're in it, you're in the system, you have requirements you have to meet. But if there were one change you could make in that traditional classroom, what would be the most important change you could make and still meet the goal, the student's needs of having to get a, you know, the goal of having to get a 5 on that test? Is it possible to, in that system?
I'll tell you what I saw in one independent school. I can't remember what this AP science course was, but it was an AP science course. And students had taken the exam in, what, early May, I think, first week of May. And they were still in school for another 5 weeks. She didn't know what to do with them. So she came up with this idea. She said, okay, I'm going to have each one of you create a scientific experiment. Along the lines of what I was just saying a minute ago. And I'm going to give you time to work. I'm going to work in pairs or in teams. And then we're going to have a period of time at the end of school when you're going to present through poster discussions what you did. So I was there for the day of the presentation. And so people were walking from all of the school, walking around to these different poster board presentations. I vividly remember one. These two young women asked the question, might there be more bacteria on eating surfaces in less expensive fast food restaurants versus more high-end restaurants? So they went around and collected the bacteria. And they analyzed them. And then they presented their findings. And they discovered, in fact, there were no significant differences. But my point was, this teacher had gone a whole year teaching this AP science course, and then finally enabled these kids to become scientists. And it was that she said they were so much more engaged, so much more articulate, so much more alive in those last 5 weeks than she'd seen in the previous 8 months. And I think what it called to mind for her was whether or not she should continue to teach AP. Last question, we're done. Before he pulls me off, I do want to say one thing to both teachers and parents here. You know, being a recovering high school English teacher, I do have to quote literature at least once. It's kind of in the job description. I'm sure you all remember the opening detail to Cities, don't you, right? No. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. These are really, really challenging times for us as both parents and teachers. You know it far better than I. It's a scary time to be a parent. It's a challenging time to be a teacher. And so I simply want to really express tremendous appreciation for this group collectively and for your leadership, who I think are really asking the right questions and are trying to move in the right ways and are turning some of these most challenging and difficult circumstances into what seemed to me to be also the best of times. Thank you very much.
It really is a pleasure, of course, to have Dr. Wagner here. We do have a small appreciation for your effort. It is a shirt, so he has to wear it at this conference in Singapore tomorrow. again, we are really thrilled to have Dr. Wagner here, and he's going to advertise for yes.
For those of you that are staff that have books, I know you'd like to have them signed. Dr. Wagner's happy to do that afterwards for a little bit. Jennifer is saying out in the foyer.
Yes, band's
practicing here. So, yes, the band's practicing in here since they picked them up. Again, for parents, thank you for coming. These are provocative questions that we are asking very seriously as a school. How do we ensure that our children have the skills and abilities in order to be successful in this century ahead of them, while at the same time doing it within a context of a system that doesn't know how to understand that? And we're translating that and working very hard at doing that. We're at a very exciting time. Our high school worked for 2 years on researching and putting in place a set of recommendations. And next fall, they're beginning to fully implement a series of those recommendations, including an advisory, including advanced topic courses, which we're going to be seeing, including catalyst projects, which all link directly to the kinds of things that Dr. Wagner referred to. Our elementary school, our early learning center, and our middle school are coming forward with their recommendations this month. And next year will be a year where they begin to build capacity around the same kinds of things so that we have a P-12 system that builds these skills for kids over time. Because what we want for kids is to make sure that they have these abilities so that they can truly be great thinkers and be prepared for their future. Thank you again, and again, stay and chat with Dr. Wagner if you'd like. Again, we appreciate your attendance this afternoon.